Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Claire McCulley. I'm Vice President for Advancement. And my department, with that of Robbie Allison's event planning class, are hosting today's Alumni Day here on campus. And we are delighted to have you all here, so thank you for coming. We are so grateful to our alumni here on the panel for coming back today. And I would like them to first introduce themselves by telling them their names, the class year, and their major. And then we're going to get started with a conversation. So I'll start off with Dan.
Hi, I'm Dan Droz, class of 2009. I was hotel administration major.
Bill Maddock, I'm also class of 09, sports management.
Mike Riley, class of 2006, communications.
James Moran, class of 2011, and culinary management.
Melissa Villalobos, class of 2005, and hospitality.
Great. All right. So, first question, pressing question is, why did you choose Newbury College? Who would like to start? Great. Okay. Well, I chose Newbury College.
I'll go. All right.
Go ahead.
Basically, for me, I wanted something small. I wanted to kind of just, you know, be like a family, and that was my whole thing. So all the colleges that I applied to were actually small colleges. I didn't apply to UMass Boston or Amherst or any of those. So that, I knew what I wanted, and then when I came here, I was like, all right, sold. So, yeah, and it's great. I mean, it was awesome. Can't complain. So.
I chose Newbury also because it was small. I was basically between Newbury, Johnson & Wales, and New England Culinary Institute, and didn't really hear about Newbury until one of my sister's friends who came here. She took me on campus, and I saw how small it was, and I liked what it was. Whereas Johnson & Wales, my second school, was basically too big for me, whereas Newbury was more of an individualized class style, where you were able to talk directly with your professors, whereas I saw some classes at other colleges where it was basically 50, 60 kids and one professor. Again, just the size.
I'm going to hold the mic. I don't feel like leaning into it. But yeah, it's pretty much the same thing with these guys said, too. Small atmosphere, real community-like feel, too. And a sense of welcoming right off the bat when I came in for a couple of those open houses. And it just made you feel like this is a good place. And a lot of good people that work here. And even at the time when I came in 14 years ago to check it out for the first time, I see a lot of the same faces that are still here, and they're still part of the Newbury community. So that says a lot right there. And I really like the hands-on experience with the small classes because you're able to do more and kind of have that individual professional relationship with a professor if you need questions or so forth.
I was a little bit different, I guess, than all these guys. Because I transferred in here, I didn't start at Newbury. You know, one of the reasons, I guess, instead of out of high school, but out of my first year of college when I was looking for another school, is actually Newbury provided me the opportunity to play two sports when my old school only allowed me to play one. And then when I was at my first school, I was a completely different major, different college setting, so it kind of just flipped at 180 when I was looking for Newbury. I got drawn to Newbury because I actually had friends already here, so it was an easy transition, and just to provide a lot more opportunities for me.
I had a little bit different approach too. I was an older student when I came in. I was in my late 20s when I was a freshman. So for me, it was the career development aspect, being able to know coming into a hotel culinary degree, I'd be able to find a job afterwards. And it was also the cost of the school was definitely in there. It was the right fit. The first person I met on campus was Sal Liberto, and it was great to have him come back, and that just, he really helped make it feel like home, so it was just a great overall feel and fit for me.
Terrific. Thank you. So I'd like you to talk a little bit about your careers and, you know, the paths that you have taken and how Newbury might or might not have helped you with that career path. Of course, the question is if it did help you, of course, but...
I guess I go. I started working in hotels when I was in high school, and that's kind of what prompted me to kind of go into hospitality. So I've done food and beverage, corporate sales, group sales, catering sales, you know, I've done it all, and right in my current position, I'm executive assistant to the VP of the Saunders. So for me, it's, you know, it was great. I mean, everything that I learned, all the food and beverage classes, the event classes, everything, it definitely has helped me in my career. So.
Sorry about that. Newbury also helped because I really started my career in food service. I actually worked for the rival Johnson & Wales, but that it was definitely good to get into there, showing that I went from going to one culinary school, but ended up working for another. So that definitely, in the position I'm in now, food service director at Eurus Dining, definitely helps, showing that I went to one culinary school, worked for another, and they were constantly saying, oh, you went to Johnson & Wales, you went to Johnson & Wales. I said, no, I just worked for them. I went to Newbury, and they were just surprised how I was able to work for a rival school coming from here. So it definitely helped.
I started doing work at my public access TV station at home in high school, announcing games for football, basketball, baseball, hockey, and I did some PA announcing on the side too. So it's a little different. You know, you have play-by-play on TV, and PA is when you go to a stadium, you hear the sound. So it's you get the best of both worlds. So I really focused on that, and I actually did the PA announcing here at Newbury when I was starting my sophomore year for basketball and volleyball down at Helena College. So I thought that was like the coolest thing in the world because that's where Larry Bird used to practice, all the Kevin McHale, Robert Parrish, Celtics used to be there. And I'm like, wow, this is great. So I did an internship my senior year. Actually, even before that, I had two internships. I had one my sophomore year at WEEI, which at the time was the only sports station in Boston, radio. And then my senior year, I did one at New England Cable News and sports. And that turned into a part-time job for me. I ended up at the assignment desk and doing some sports behind-the-scenes stuff. And then eventually I jumped into the on-air side of things on the radio. So, yeah, Newbury helped definitely with the hands-on situation. The internship is huge. Definitely tap into that. It was kind of interesting, too, when I went for those internships. They're like, where's Newbury College? So I told them, and like, wow, okay, that's great. And, you know, you get a lot of, in this communications industry, you get a lot of Syracuse, Boston University, Emerson, but it's nice to represent Newbury and show that you can do what you want to do with your degree. It doesn't matter where you go, it matters what you do with your degree. So tap into it and take advantage of it.
Yeah, for me, it was a little bit unorthodox again. You know, not only was the in-classroom stuff that I learned, but it was the, you know, for me, on-the-field stuff that allowed me to get to where I am. Right now, down at Fisher College, right down the street, I'm the assistant athletic director, sports information director, head men's and women's soccer coach, and an assistant baseball coach. All right, so I do a little bit of everything over there. But that's what it was. You know, obviously, this sports management degree allowed me to excel in the career of athletic administration. I used my internships to parlay into a full-time job, but then it was my playing experience that allowed me to get my initial job at Fisher, which was a full-year unpaid internship coaching on the baseball team, and that finally morphed into a full-time position over there. So, you know, Newbury definitely helped in that aspect, that it wasn't just, like I said, in the classroom that I was getting a lot of experience. You know, it was taking the advantage of everything that's part of the community that allowed me to get to where I am today.
So mine was kind of a little bit all over the place as well. I actually got my start through a field trip that we took for a sales class here, and that was my first internship at a small hotel up on Beacon Hill. And ironically enough, a couple months ago, they contacted me to come back for a part-time job because I knew the property. So it's kind of gone back and forth. I've been lucky enough to have a company transfer me to Los Angeles and back for a job, and now just from networking, a lot of the events were through Newbury, whether it was scholarship dinners or things like that. Just, you know, you get to meet other alumni who are in the industry, you get to meet other people in the industry, and the school does carry a certain amount of weight, especially, you know, hotel, culinary, communications, everyone kind of mixes together at some point. And it led to the position I'm in now, where it's basically a power networking job. So you really do get to make a lot of great connections. And it's like Billy said, you're on the field, on the job training. So it never really ends, not in the classroom, not when you're out of it, because you run into people everywhere.
So as you were talking about Newbury being a small school, and everybody knows you, was there a particular person, a professor, a staff person, who who had an impact on you that you have a story to tell, or something that, you know, had something to do with your career or your life that was life-changing? And anybody can start.
I think for me, I originally started culinary, and it was Chef Barry. And it's just one of those where sometimes you just meet someone that can push you and figures out how to push your buttons and toughens your skin up. And that was, I've joked with Miss Allison before, she knows kind of the full version of this story, but I've never earned a C minus in my life before, and I did in that one. But it was the hardest class I had to fight to get through, and it pushed me to wake up every morning. But doing what I do now, you're in the lobby of a hotel, you're the MOD, it stops with you, you're getting screamed at, and in the back of your head, all I can hear is just cut faster. So it really prepared me. It prepped for everything I've gone through, so.
Oh, do tell the story.
You know, for me, it was, you know, in the sports management and having Newbury as such a small community. You know, my coaches obviously had a huge impact. The professors had an impact. And some of you guys are going to laugh, but Pete Santola. I know. He's the former athletic director here. He is one not to be forgotten. Yeah, he's a character for sure. I actually wish Ken was here, because he dressed up as a 1 year for Halloween. But you know, he was always available, and that's part of what you get here in Newbury, is that the professors, the staff, the coaches, they're always available. You see it a lot in the athletics world. You know, in the big universities, the AD is not approachable, the head coach isn't always approachable. Well, you know, I still talk to Pete. You know, I still talk to Greg Sullivan, who was my baseball mm-hmm. coach, is over at BC now. You know, they're some of my references. So it's those connections that you make because these professors and these staff members are always available that are going to last you throughout your professional careers.
Yeah, I kind of have a similar situation with that with Pete too, because I worked under Pete doing the PA announcing and all that. And but there was someone I still talk to this day. I had a professor in radio. You know, he doesn't teach her anymore, unfortunately, but Chris Palermo was actually a student here at Newbury. And he worked at WBZ News Radio for a long time. And I probably talked to Chris 3-4 times a month, I'd say. And, you know, we stayed in touch for a while. He helped me land a couple of gigs, and you know, he helped me get over at 98.5 The Sports Hub and WBZ with his connections there, and he did my demo for me. But right there, I've known him for 12 years, and that's someone who I tap into as a network and a reference and so forth. Couple other ones, too, that are no longer here, but we chat maybe, I'd say, once every other month, just to, hey, how you doing? What's going on? One works at Channel 7. Somebody works at Comcast Sportsnet. So, again, guys that went here, I was in the same classroom as them, and for some that also taught me the ropes on it, it's nice to be able to stay in contact with them, because at other larger universities, you can't even get near your professor sometimes. You might just send an email, hey, how did I do on that test? Or, you know, just a quick question. It might take a couple of days for me to get back to you. Right here, it's more of a direct impact. You can get an answer within a matter of seconds.
The biggest impact on me would probably be Chef K. She was my first culinary instructor that I had for Culinary Concepts. I still talk to her this day, again, like these guys, probably at least 2-3 times a month, just talking to her. She's still a good friend of mine. Really, just first time going into the class, she was just a fun, loving person, outgoing. She made you want to be there. Whereas some classes, you'd sit down and You're like, all right, do I really have to come to this class right now? But when you're, when I felt like when I was going to Chef Kay's, any of her classes, I wanted to be there. Whether I had her during that semester or not, I could go to her, I could ask her questions. She was always willing to talk and help out.
With me, I guess I'm kind of torn. I had Miss Allison, and I also had Mr. Pelletier, who, again, is he still here?
Mm-hmm.
Oh. you know, with Miss Allison, I mean, we've kept in touch, and I must say that if it wasn't for their classes and their one-on-ones, then I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing now, so thank you.
So if you had one piece of advice to give to our students who are there, what would that be?
I'd say the biggest one is be active. Go out, do some stuff. The only friends of mine who have ever had a problem getting a job or have had a problem networking or, you know, don't know what to do are the ones who hang out in your dorm rooms. And when I've come back to teach a couple classes, I've told the story where, you know, college parties are great and, you know, go to them, have fun. But set yourself up for when you're going to a party, when you post-grad, and, you know, Tessio's DJing, Grey Goose is doing the liquor, and Grill 23 is doing the food. That's a party, and it's at Royale, and everything's catered, and everything's comp. That's the stuff you set yourself up to get the invites for, and you'll be getting those before you graduate. All it takes is a little time. You don't even have to have the big name job. You know, a lot of places will give you these invites just to get you out as a thank you for doing the grunt work. So just set yourself up, take advantage of it, say yes to people, say yes to working for free just to get credit and experience, and it'll lead to something better for you. So.
Yeah, the first phrase that came into my mind when the question was asked was buy-in. You know, it's something that we use, you know, in the athletics world a lot. But when I say to that, obviously it's the curriculum, the courses that you're taking to get a good understanding of what you're doing. You know, I can tell you right now some of the classes that I took, you know, 6 years ago that I'm the information that I'm using still today. You know, and then the connections that you make, you know, whether it be the staff or even the guys or ladies sitting right next to you. You know, because they're going to help you further develop in all aspects too. So just buy into everything that Newbury has to offer.
Yeah, I like that. Another thing too I think is really beneficial for students now, especially if you're going to networking events, make up business cards. You know, it doesn't mean you're working for a specific company, but have your name, phone number, and email on there. Because if you're going to networking events, people aren't going to pull out a pen and paper and like, okay, get your name and phone number. It takes too much time. Just give them a business card. Get those made. It's like, I don't know, 10 bucks for 1,000 of them or something, Vistaprint or whatever. Cheap plug for them. but I definitely recommend those. Go to as many networking events as possible. Have a broad mind too on things. Don't, I mean, it's great to have a tunnel vision to be focused on one specific major, which is great, but don't be afraid to think outside the box if that may not be a reality for your specific major. Think about some other possibilities too and look at whatever is out there, especially if you're a communications major, don't be afraid to look at a business networking you know, situation, or I don't know, a science one or anything along those, or hotel one. Just, it's good to tap into as many people you know as possible because you may need them down the line, whether it's for your major or not.
My biggest thing is, you hear it a lot, but do what you love. I've always been in the food industry, whether it's been in, I've worked fast food, I've worked nursing homes, I've worked hotels, now corporate dining. I've always been around food. It's the one thing I love. It's, I love making it, I love selling it, I love eating it. So, I mean, if you're around what you love, who says it has to be work? It's, you're just doing what you do. I'm in 12, 14 hours a day sometimes, not necessarily always around food, but I'll jump in there, I'll help my guys out, because unfortunately I no longer wear a chef coat, but I'll jump in there, I'll help them out just because I want to get my hands dirty again. It's just, it's what I love, so why would I stray away from that?
I mean, I would definitely have to say networking. It's all about who you know. You have to get your name out there.
And one of the main things I would say is don't burn any bridges, because hotels are, in the industry, hotels are small and everyone knows everyone. And if you have a good reputation, that will follow you a long way, so.
That is excellent advice for all of us. When you think back about what you learned, or something that you learned at Newbury, is there one memory that you have where you thought, oh, that I remember from learning from Newbury, or it comes to you hear maybe Ms. Allison's voice in your head, or Ms. Roberts saying, and I told you, or Ms. Sheckles who said, you know, networking matters, or that. Can you think about some advice that you heard that you apply in your work?
The first thing that came to my mind was just Mr. Pelletier had always said, be ready, because you don't know when an opportunity is going to strike. And Ms. Allison said it before. I think every professor says it at some point. You never know what's going to happen. I've had times where I've been invited for lunch into places, and it turned into a job interview. I've had times I've been out at a bar, and you never know who you run into. One of my best business contacts that I have and use, who's now become a client of mine, I met because his SUV was next to mine tailgating at a Patriots game, and he heard somebody say my job title next to him. And this was in 0-degree weather after the AFC Championship game, and everyone was in no condition to be talking business, but it worked. So you never know when lightning's going to strike. Keep your resume updated on your phone. Keep it on the cloud. Definitely, like you said, grab some business cards. Make sure you have them on you. You never know what's going to happen, who's next to you. So be careful who you're talking to, what you're saying, and don't burn bridges, because you never know when you're going to run into somebody again.
Yeah, when I was playing baseball here, there was one word that my coach constantly yelled, and that was compete, all the time. But not only for, you know, playing on the field, but in the classroom, stuff like that. You know, for the sports management world and all the sports, and I guess this goes probably for everybody, it's a cutthroat world out there. It's very competitive, you know, so constantly evolving as a professional is very important for you guys. You know, we're constantly kind of competing against each other. I mean, Andrew and I were literally just talking 5 minutes ago about setting a game up for next year. You know, so we're constantly competing. But you're going to be forced to kind of constantly, evolve as a professional. And I was thinking on the drive over here, it's like I still have my sports management textbooks in my office at Fisher just in case I need to figure out how to do something. You know, and that's what it is. It's you're gonna have to be able to use these resources and just continue to evolve.
Yeah, I wish I could just copy what they just said. It's pretty much the same thing. Not to beat a dead horse. In my industry, I couldn't have said it better. You don't want to burn any bridges, say anything bad about anybody, and be careful what you say. It's a social media world now too. You got to be very careful what you put on Facebook, Twitter, even Instagram too. But be very, very cautious of that. Employers, I think they're looking into that now. They do a little background check on you with your Facebook profile and, you know, your Twitter stuff. So you got to be very cautious of what is said. Even my industry, if I'm at a Patriots media practice, media day. Before practice, and you may get some information. Perfect example, yesterday Jamie Collins just decided, he said he's able to come back. He was out 2 weeks with an illness. You're not able to say ahead of time, we kind of knew what that illness was, but we weren't able to say it was off the record. If you are to say that without his permission, you could get into a lot of trouble. So be very careful with situations like that. Never burn any bridges. And I think one thing, just to go back what I said before with the networking thing, though, to change gears a little, that is something I really took into account here at Newbury. Everybody constantly said it. I'm like, all right, enough. I get it. But now I know why. I know why. It is so important to do that. Meet as many people as possible. Shake their hands. Put a happy face on. And just be yourself and put yourself out there and show them that you want the job, that you're ready to do it. Life is a sales job. I mean, you may not be in sales, but you're selling yourself.
My biggest thing was most, if not all culinary and hospitality should know mise en place. have everything in his place, everything in order, not just for work and working in the kitchen and working on food. If you've got everything in order, it makes life just go a lot easier. If you're running around getting this, getting that, it'll take a lot longer to come to the final product. Whereas if I've got everything I need to conduct, even when I'm working in the office, if I've got all my information right in front of me, I can just plug it all in. Whereas if I have to go get this, I have to go get that, I have to go check this inventory, I have to go do that, then it'll take me 2, 3, 4 times longer than it should. But if you just get everything together, just keep yourself organized, and it'll definitely help you out in the long run.
I remember one of my professors said that the person next to you is going to be the person that you're going to go up in a job interview. And that's exactly, you know, it's like, I remember when we were in college, we all wanted to get into like the catering and sales and that kind of stuff. And it was like everyone was kind of going for the same job. And, you know, there was not that many jobs out there. So that's one thing. So you always have to try to stick out from, you know, the person next to you.
And if you had to do it all over again, would you study what you studied at Newbury? Would you study something different?
Yeah, for me, I probably would have started here. yeah, I mean that's the answer for me.
Yeah.
I mean, the food's so good, I'd probably go into culinary. It's pretty spoiled by the buffets and everything. Unbelievable. You guys are great, the chefs and so forth. It's actually pretty funny when people ask where you went to school. Oh, yeah, Newbury College. Oh, that's the culinary school, right? Yeah, it is. They got a great reputation for it. But, yeah, I'm pretty – you can't have regrets in life. You can't have that. But I'd stay the path. Definitely would.
No, I mean, it's just – I think we're kind of all reiterating the same thing. But, yeah, it's I wouldn't change a thing about it. If anything, I might have tried coming back a little earlier. But everything about this really helps set me up for what I'm doing now. And I don't think I'd be in the position I'm in now without the support and kind of what I learned here and the opportunities that it gave me. So,
I would 100% definitely do the same thing over again. Same major, same, if I could pick same classes, same professors. One thing I would change, instead of having a roommate, I'd be by myself because they like to steal the food I took back from classes.
That happens, huh? So now I'd like to open up from questions from the students here, because I've asked, you know, some of the basic questions, but I know that you all may have particular questions. So who would like to start? Don't be shy. This is your opportunity. Yes, in the back.
I think the biggest one, it probably challenges everyone, is that first interview you go into. It's just getting used to being in that situation where you're being asked questions and to get your answers right and your timing right. Get your voice right so you don't sound nervous, and really just get through that first experience of interviewing. Once you get your foot in the door and you've got some experience, everything comes a lot easier. You find out you have common friends with people. People refer you to other ones, but it's just getting over that first hurdle. And that's really just, it kind of ties everything together here with, I was fortunate enough to come back and teach a class last semester, and what I told the students then, and hopefully this will help you guys ask us some questions, was I told them it was a 9-week job interview. We're the ones who are going to be hiring you guys. We're the ones who you'll be working with. You're going to run into us in 2, 3 years, even maybe a month from now, out in the professional world. And anything you ask us, we tend to remember stuff. You know, we might not remember names, but we'll remember a question or a face or a voice. And this is all about the people you know. So ask away, and something's going to hit a light with somebody. So.
Yeah, for me, it was initially buying into the fact that I was going to work for a place for free for a year. you know, that's how I got to Newbury. When I was in grad school, you know, much like the Newbury curriculum, you know, we needed to do an internship. And when I moved on to grad school, we had to do the same thing. And my grad school internship was working in an athletic department. You know, and so I had to buy into the fact that, you know, maybe I was going to financially struggle for a little bit, but it definitely led to a pretty unique opportunity. Mm-hmm. And that was probably the biggest hurdle was not knowing what's going to come out of the decisions that you're making. You know, I was fortunate enough to get that full-time job after that year. You know, some of you guys might not right away, but don't let that stop you kind of grinding it out, because eventually it's going to get there. And I don't think, I'll tell you right now, I definitely didn't think, 6 years ago that I'd be in this position with this job title now, but I wouldn't change it for anything.
My biggest challenge, definitely having bosses or anybody call or email you back when you want a specific position and you want to get into it, it's hard because, it's like, what the hell's going on here? I sent you my resume, I sent you my demo. Why am I not hearing anything back? You may not hear back for 2 weeks to 2 months, but constantly check in at least once a week. I always find, too, the best day of the week to shoot an email to a boss is a Tuesday. Mondays are terrible. They're getting back into it. Tuesday, they're getting back in the groove. So they're, like, ready to go. So use that, too. But definitely, that's probably the biggest challenge. And again, to go back to the networking situation, I tap into my network. People that know someone who I'm trying to get a hold of, they could call them or shoot an email. Hey, Mike Riley's trying to get a hold of you. Can you just give him a call back if you don't mind? And next thing you know, you get a call back. So it's good to have that sort of connection with people.
My biggest challenge was going from working at a small hotel where I was managing maybe 3-4 people at most, and then going into a position where I now manage up to 25 employees. So that's definitely a big change, because really you can take care of 3-4 people. It's not a problem. But then when you've got a kitchen full of 18 people, then I've got 5 outtakes that are coming out of mine, 5 satellite units that are coming out of mine. I really need to focus my attention on my whole unit and then other units besides mine. Definitely a big hurdle to jump over and take grasp on that.
My biggest challenge after college was trying to figure out, I knew I wanted to be in hotels, I just didn't know exactly what I wanted to do. So I just kind of tried everything. I did food and beverage, I did sales, and then you just find what you love, and eventually it's just a progress. So just work hard.
Yes, Ms. Allison.
Talk a little bit about what you did outside of the classroom at Newbury, what clubs, I know you played sports, but what sort of extracurricular activities were you involved in?
So I was president of the Innkeepers Club for a couple of years. I was also a resident assistant for 2 years, and it really helped. It was almost like a small management aspect. You really kind of got to hone leadership. You learned how to separate. I learned how to separate friendship from work, and that really helped out later in my career too. Because eventually, you're going to work with friends. When I came back to Boston from my time in LA, one of the guys I had to oversee, actually two people I had to oversee, were best friends of mine. One was the best man at my wedding. And now I'm his direct supervisor. So when you have to discipline someone who you've known for forever, and this is one of the people you go for drinks with, and you go to when you have problems and you're venting to, you have to learn to make those separations. And if you can start doing that while you're in school, and you learn that there has to be there's a separation of it. There's work and there's personal, and don't blur that line. And if your friends are your friends, and they'll know when to turn it off. But that was something that being in those two organizations really helped with. And people understood that, and it really helped me kind of hone and get a jump on things that way.
Yeah, I mean, I was a two-sport athlete here, and I was a member of the SAC committee and everything like that. The biggest thing for me in my professional life was gaining the kind of the leadership positions, here. Being a captain of both teams, that is something that future employees are going to look at, whether or not you can lead a group of 25 guys or not. Or if you can lead a team or anything like that. So, I guess my experiences here was very much sports oriented for sure. But that may not be the case for all you guys, but branch out and get involved in as many things as possible.
I try not to have any regrets in life, but I think that was that probably one of my regrets. I didn't take part in any of the clubs or whatnot. I think I was just very career driven. And the only outside thing I really did for Newbury was the PA announcing for the athletics. That's the only really thing. And again, I wish I had done more looking back on it. But in this field, it's very hard because I was also balancing an internship too at a major radio station, where if you have that opportunity for hours that they're giving you, you take it. So I think that's why I couldn't really commit to too many things. So if you have the chance to tap into any sort of, you know, club activity on campus, great way to do it. Like these guys are saying, you meet a lot of people, and you're part of the community too.
The biggest thing I did was whenever there was an open house or some kind of event where culinary students were asked to help out, I would jump at the bit at that, because again, like I said earlier, I love working with food. So why not go and help out, make some food that you wouldn't necessarily make in your classes? Anytime there was any open house, I would jump at that and just definitely took advantage of that, because why not do what you love?
I unfortunately did not really do too much at Newbury. I went to school full time and I worked full time, so that was all my time, unfortunately. And I do regret that, but you know, yes, it's just how it goes.
Yes, Jesse.
I was lucky enough, I got right into the concierge world, so it was, you get invited to a lot of events, and you can really kind of pick and choose, and it networks everywhere. The job I'm doing now really kind of helped me gear towards that. What I do now, we're contracted with 40 hotels and 160 vendors, and so anything anyone would need to do in the city, we can, or outside the city, we can go to. So my interests are sports. I've met with Patriot Place, I was on the phone with the Red Sox last night, so we can really, you can gear towards what you like. If there's something you want to do, figure out a way to work it into your job. Figure out an angle. There's a way to make anything work, and that's something you learn in this industry. You can really work, be innovative, and that's what people want. Employers don't want groupies. They want rock stars. Figure out a way to do it. Figure out a way to make something work. Figure out something no one's thought of. And don't just think of a way. Do a plan with it. Write a SWOT analysis. Present that to your boss. Don't just take something that you know and you're good at and you're interested in and squash it, or do it on the side and hide it. Figure out a way to make it work for you. And that's what your employers are going to remember, and that's what everyone's going to come up with. And somewhere along the line, you're going to be in an interview and someone's going to say something across the table from you that they're interested in, and that's your in, because that's all they're going to remember is something about you reminded them of them. So bring it up and talk about yourself, and don't be afraid of something you're interested in.
Yeah, for me, I guess it was just not shying away from those other interests. I knew as soon as I stepped on this campus here that I was going to try to get into the sports world. But then I also used Newbury as an outlet to sometimes not always doing sports. It's weird. Like the one class I remember that's not sports management class was Debbie Mayo's Fairy Tales class. I took it my senior year, and it was kind of an escape from everything that I had geared towards while I was here. Every day it was a sports management class, and it was either soccer practice or baseball practice, or at some point in the winter we were helping out practicing with a women's basketball team because they needed bodies at practice. So it was always sports, 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 but then, Newbury allowed me to kind of shut that off for a minute, relax, kind of get a little more well-rounded, and that was it.
Yeah, pretty similar too. Math is probably my worst nightmare outside of you know, things in life and maybe a little bit of science. I mean, what do I need that in my field for? I can just pick up a calculator, basic math. But yeah, it was, you know, you're so focused on in a radio class or a public speaking class where you want to nail the speech down. It's kind of nice to branch out just for a little bit to clear your mind on it. I learned about the human anatomy in a science class and everything, and it's like, okay, you know, it's kind of cool, but you need to do it. And I'm glad, I like what, just to touch what Dan said here before, you know, bring something to the table too when you get something with the job. A couple months ago over at WBZ, I was talking to my boss, and BC football, they had a Friday night game. BC was terrible this year, by the way, but they had a really good game against Florida State. Florida State was top 10 in the country. So I said, hey, you know, why don't we go over there? We'll, you know, send a reporter over. I'll go over Friday night. Great, let's do it. So they liked it so much, and they're going to send me to Fenway Park Saturday night, BC Notre Dame. And then also to Gillette Stadium New Year's Day for the Winter Classic. So bring something to the table. You make an impact like that, they'll remember that. Don't just expect it or think it's going to happen. Go out there and put yourself out there.
It was definitely tough trying to juggle the things that I liked, because I liked playing volleyball. I was coming to school to get an education, but at the same time, like everybody else, I needed to work. I needed to pay my bill. So I had to end up dropping volleyball. Couldn't play. I had to end up work. But I was able to do work study for athletics. So I was still taking my classes, doing the food that I love, but then I was able to do athletics, and I worked the volleyball games even though I couldn't play them. I was able to do that, and if culinary wasn't my thing, I think I would have liked sports management, because doing work study there, I loved being around the sports, whether it be basketball, volleyball, being at the soccer games. It's definitely tough to juggle. Even now, working 60, 70 hours a week, I still find some time to play volleyball. I play volleyball once a week during the summer. I play softball, but definitely tough to juggle. But always try to find a way to do what you enjoy doing on the side.
Time management, I still struggle with that now. It's hard. It's basically, you just have to try to make it work. You know, it's things we don't want to do, but you have to do. And then you'd be surprised that you actually enjoyed that class that you didn't want to take. But it's just things that we have to do, and you'll be surprised. That's what I always say to myself.
You got a question? Go ahead.
I definitely have. I actually lived overseas before when I was in high school, so I've kind of experienced that. And, you know, that's, you know, how I credit a lot of my soccer background. I lived in England for 5 years, you know, played in some youth systems over there, so you get a different perspective than what it is over here. So that experience definitely helped me lead to the position I'm in now. Yeah, Newbury didn't technically provide that opportunity of me going abroad, but I think it's definitely a good thing if you guys are interested in studying abroad. I would say, you know, it's an experience that you might not ever get in a lifetime if you don't take advantage of it now. So if you're thinking about doing abroad, then do it. You know, and there's jobs, these jobs that we all have, you know, they're available everywhere in the world. You might, just because you don't get a job in Boston doesn't mean you can't get a job anywhere else.
It wasn't abroad. I mean, before I just recently switched jobs, I was being groomed to actually be transferred to a position in a different country. And something about my time when I was transferred out to LA kind of resonated with me is, if you're going to relocate, make sure you're doing your research on where you're going to, just to make sure it's a right fit culture-wise for you. Don't just go in and assume everything's going to be the same, because some things just aren't the right fit. But it's like any other job. If you're going to go for an interview, you know, you want to know the culture of the place. I've always said to people before you interview, make sure you're going in and just sit in the lobby and take a look around, take a look at what mm-hmm. the employees are like, see if they're happy, see what the flow is like. The same thing can be said about going abroad. Get an idea of what you're getting yourself into. I mean, it's a phenomenal experience. I would have loved to have done it. For the right thing, and I was all for this transfer before something better happened here. But is just make sure you know what you're getting into and get an idea of what's going on in the culture there and the organization. Take a look at what apartments are like, just so you know what you're getting yourself into, so you can prepare yourself for what you can bring. There's some countries where you can only bring certain things and you can only bring certain weight. You're going with two suitcases. I've had friends who've done time in London and then ended up in Hawaii or whatnot. So people are fluid with what they do. But take a look at what you're getting into, because sometimes one door closes, another one opens, and you might end up in a different country you didn't think of that's just a better fit for you.
Yeah, just to answer your question, I haven't shut that off completely. Something I really haven't focused on too much. I'm pretty comfortable here in the Boston market. I'm pretty fortunate to be here in such a competitive sports market and so forth. But, you know, when you talk about going abroad, when I was a student here, it wasn't that popular. I graduated in 2006, so it was starting to get a little more popular, the studying abroad for a semester. Both my brothers, who are a couple years younger, they both went to Italy for a semester, and actually that was a great excuse for my whole family to take a trip over there. So it's a great thing to do, and looking back on it, yeah, I would do it in a heartbeat. But don't be afraid to get out of your comfort zone, too. Do not be afraid to. Look at the right situation, make sure it is the right thing to do, and do your homework on it before you pull the trigger on it, because it could set up for a disaster. So make sure you get everything down, ready to go.
I've never studied abroad or worked abroad or anything. When I was here, I was interested in, there was an opportunity in Ireland, but by the time I went to the meeting in found out about it, it was a little too late to take advantage of that. But now working with Compass Group, and it's a worldwide organization, it's not saying if they offered me an opportunity to work in Paris or Italy or anywhere outside of the U.S., I wouldn't take. I would definitely take a look at it and see what it was worth, because, I mean, who doesn't want to go somewhere else out of the norm?
I would have loved to do it. We did something similar when I was a senior here. We did two courses, and we went to Italy, France, and Monaco for a few weeks, and so that was really great. Stayed at vineyards and things like that. So that was very exciting. So that's the closest thing to, I guess, abroad that you know, that I came to. But I mean, I would love the offer. If I could go back, I would definitely do it.
Questions? Yes.
For me, it started off as like the dream situation. I walked into the hotel in Boston. It was February. We just had 12 inches of snow. It was 5 degrees. And the HR director was waiting for me, pulled me into the office and goes, "How do you feel about Pasadena? It's 85 degrees and the guest services team needs a reboot." So 6 months later, I'm on the plane going to Pasadena. I settle in and I realize that when people talk about LA, they don't mean LA itself, they mean LA County. So I go from a city that's 4 miles across to one that's 30 miles across. And I realize as doing guest services and concierge out there, you have to get to know San Diego, you have to know the Bay Area, you have to know wine country. So it was a big thing. And then within 6 months, I had to fire my entire full-time staff and rehire an entire team from scratch while scores are going up and I'm getting pressure from Hong Kong. And I just remember coming home one day and thinking, the only place I know where to go is the grocery store in Target. And it's like, I didn't have many friends out there. It was just people I knew from work. There weren't a whole lot of outlets. I was still working on networking in, and I was just thinking, what the heck did I do? And it ended up being one of the best things for my career. The job ended up working itself out. The money ended up working itself out. When I came back to Boston, I left everything in really good standing out there. I'd done the job I was there to do, but yeah, it was just one of those where it took about 2 weeks, and I was just thinking, did I make the right move? And you really question yourself. And there's two things you can do. You can either pack up, put your tail between your legs and leave, or you can fight it out. And you really have to grind it down, and you figure out a way to make it work. And you make it work because sometimes you have to make that separation and realize the personal side will work itself out later. Mm-hmm. And you just have to focus on the career right now. And things really do work out, and they work out the way they're supposed to, and they work out for something better down the road. And you just have to have faith in that.
Yeah, my story is similar to Dan's. When I first got the soccer job at Fisher. I was 24 years old. I was, you know, flying high, you know, youngest head coach, whatever. Day one, I showed up to practice, and I coached the men and the women. And I had like 9 people at practice day one, and that's both teams combined. All right, so as soon as the day after the first practice, I was in that same situation. I went back to my office and just sat there, and I was like, "What did I just get myself into? What choice did I make? Is this the right thing? You know we're going to fail. We can't win." It took years. It's never gonna situation like that. A setback might not be able to be resolved in days and months and weeks, whatever. It took me about 5 years to turn it all around. And like Dan, I wasn't gonna just quit. I was kind of a little too competitive. So you just got the competitive juices going. I said, all right, I'm gonna take this challenge head on right now and see if we can get some sort of respect back to these programs. And by doing that and the experiences that I've gotten over the last 5 years, now I know that I can go and I think I can win anywhere. You know, if I can win it where I was and what I had to what I have now, you know, it just shows that, you know, regardless of limited resources or setback in the profession, you know, as long as you keep grinding out, as long as you keep competing, you know, you're going to be all right.
A couple years ago, I was working, the company I worked for was an outsourced company, and we provided pretty much all the traffic reports for TV and radio stations in town, and in addition, a couple of sports stations, and the one I was under was with WEEI, and I did the sports flash for them in the mornings, the morning show. And the company decided to part ways with EEI. So they gave us fair warning in advance, and I said, yeah, you know, probably going to get laid off. So I'm like, oh, damn. So did everything I could and went through my contacts to make calls to the number one state radio sports radio station in Boston, 95, the Sports Hub. And that day did come. I finally did get laid off. And it's a shot to the ego. I'm not going to lie. It is. And it's devastating. It's a little heartbreaking. And you got to go through the employment thing and unemployment thing, excuse me. Thankfully, I was only on unemployment for, I just got one check. I was only in there for 3 weeks. That was it. And I got right back at my feet. So that was probably a big bump in the road, to answer your question, for a situation like that in my career. But if you're able to be resilient and bounce back and to be ambitious for things and know that you want to do it, you can do it. It's not the end of the world.
My situation is slightly similar to being laid off. I was finally running my own kitchen. I was executive chef at the Sheraton Hotel in Warwick, Rhode Island. I'd gotten there. The kitchen was somewhat of a mess when I first was hired. So I took a couple months. I started cleaning it up. Finally got the kitchen where I needed it to be, and the menu was awful. So I said, all right, my next big project, rewrite the menu. So I started rewriting the menu, just finished writing that up. And then HR calls me on my day off saying, hey, can you come in? The GM wants to talk with you. I'm like, all right. So I go in, and come to find out, they did a company reorganization, and they're running without an executive chef. So my job was, I was let go of that job. And go home, do my thing. I wake up in the morning, like, well, life just slapped me in the face. So I went back, I picked up all my stuff from the hotel, from the kitchen, dropped my keys off. So got back home, started applying. Within 3 days, I had a phone interview. Exactly 1 month after I was laid off, I started my job with Yaris. So I mean, it's definitely layoffs will happen. I mean, they're bound to come. If it happens, just keep chugging, keep doing what you do, and just keep going. Because I mean, no one really wants to just sit at home, because that ends up, it gets tiring after a week.
I mean, I think we've all had setbacks. You know, it's just part of life, and it's how you take it. I remember one of my jobs that I had, I just absolutely hated it. And then it was kind of the same thing. You know, you get laid off and then you have your dream job after that. So it's just like, it's how you take in and what you do and how you do it.
Yes.
What did you guys do right after you graduated? Like, do you have a job lined up? Do you travel? Or was it hard to find your first job?
Yeah, just keeping it in line. I had actually, my second internship was an on-call position at the Langham, and that ended up becoming my post-grad job. But I decided to take a gamble. And it's not everything I recommend for people. You have to really know your situation within the company and know what you've done and what you mean to them. And it was a shot I took. The W Hotel was just opening. While I was in school, I had referred a bunch of friends into the Langham, so they knew I was someone who was gonna bring people in. I was invested, but graduated in May. August comes around, I still don't have benefits. They hadn't made me full-time yet. So the chance I took was I started applying other places. And I made sure that word got out that I was. And I made sure that the hotel knew. I was in the cafeteria and I started writing a couple W's on napkins. And people got the hint. And you can bet 20, 30 minutes later, I was pulled into HR to sign my full-time offer letter. So it's, know what you're doing, set yourself up. Because it's not something you can do right off the bat when you first walk into a job, but I had been at the company for 2.5 years. I had done everything they said. They trained me in 8 different jobs. And it's just, you have to know when to take your chances in your career. And this was just something I knew I could grab. And it was a calculated risk. I had a fallback. I had that other hotel and I had 3 others in reserve. Know what you're doing and just take that chance. Trust yourself, trust your instincts. And there's something to be said about a gut feeling. You know, it can happen in sports. It can happen in anything you do. Sometimes you just feel like you're making the right move. Go with it. And just trust yourself, because you're the only one who knows what's best for you. No one else is going to have your best interest in it. It's like I said, companies are going to restructure. Your boss is going to do what's best for them. You do what's best for you and trust your instincts with it.
Yeah, I didn't have a job lined up. I went to grad school right after I finished here. You know, for you guys that are looking at least to get into the sports management world, start looking at it now. The more education, the more knowledge you guys can get, it's going to prove invaluable. For me, my full-time job now was, like I said earlier, was because of my grad school internship. So it was an unpaid year, like I say, and had to grind it out, and you know, it led to good things. But yeah, right out of school, at least right out of undergrad, I just kind of stayed in the industry, in the sports world, nothing full-time until just kept going and going and going and applying, and finally something bought.
Pretty similar to these two guys. Right before graduation, I had started an internship at NECN, New England Cable News TV, and it's unpaid. But a couple months in, I'm like, all right, I got to start making some money here. And I still had some contacts from where I was interning before over at WEEI, sophomore year or whatever. And I'm like, anything, guys, anything? And they're like, well, you know, we actually have a street team. We're called the Water Boys and the Water Girls. And what we do is you go out to bars and outside Fenway Park, hand out K cards. You do promotions for Budweiser, Coors Light, and all that. It's actually really fun. And you know, they're like, yeah, it's minimum wage, $8.25 an hour. I'm like, I'll take it. I don't care. I'll do it. So I did that for a little bit, probably a couple months. And then I'd say the fall of right after I graduated, I got offered while I was still interning at NECN, so I was juggling an internship and a part-time gig at EEI. I got work at the assignment desk at NECN, which then evolved into full-time work, which was great. For a couple of years. So stay hard, stay working hard, and just stay on the path that you want to do, because if you want to do it, you definitely can do it.
Just after I left here, going home, there wasn't much that I knew of that was open, so I contacted the chef I had for my second internship, and he was looking for some help, so he brought me on part-time. And I needed more than part-time, so I was working with him until I could find something else, and then I was able to contact the place I used to work when I was in high school. They said they were looking for banquet cook there full time, so I was able to. Because of the networking that I done while I was working throughout to start my career, it was because of them that helped me out get that position. But clearly, so far with the four of us, the internships have definitely helped us out. So mm-hmm. with internships, definitely take it 100%. Show them what you can do, because you can 95% of the time probably get a position out of that when you're done with them.
After college, I went home and I actually traveled for 3 months, which was great. And after that, I started working full time and started working two jobs. And now it's just back here and it's great.
Anybody else? Yes.
For me, it's I don't do the same thing every day. Every day there's a different issue or a different, something going on that's different, especially for me in coaching. Obviously, I just finished kind of my heavy season, being in season. But yeah, I mean, the biggest thing, and I always say, everybody always asks me, do you like what you do? Is I don't sit at a desk and crunch numbers that I have no idea what they mean. Like, I'm doing what I love, and that's the biggest thing. That's why I chose sports management, because I love sports from when I was a little kid. Couldn't think of another profession to be in.
Yeah, I don't even feel like I'm at work when I'm at work now. And I think that's a good thing. You want to have fun with it. So probably, you have a microphone in front of you. You have about a million listeners at once from all over the region. So you just got to pretend that microphone's not in front of you. You're having a conversation with one person right in front of you. It's all it's about. So definitely being on the air, talking in front of the microphone, and just being at work. It's not even work. It's fun. That's how work should be.
Best thing about my job, if you even want to call it a job, is just working with food. Again, I love the food and I just keep going back to it. And it also doesn't hurt that I'm in food service and I'm working Monday through Friday. Not many people can say that.
Yeah.
I'm in that six out of six, basically. So food service, it's tough to find that. So I can't complain about that at all.
Best thing for me is definitely just meeting people every day. My job's always different. I never know what I'm gonna go into. And just, just meeting all different types of people from all over the world, and that makes it always exciting for me.
I forget who said it, but it's, for me, I have fun doing what I'm doing. It doesn't feel like work. It's, the perks of it are great once you're building up a network. And I mean, I've had friends who say everything comes easy to you. Well, no, my first internship, I was shining shoes. Don't forget that part. It took 8 years to get where I am now, and that's why I'm enjoying it. You can go out, you can do what you want. You've got contacts everywhere. You can call these people up. They call you, invite you in and stuff. But it's, you have fun doing what you're doing. It doesn't feel like work. And then you can actually relax. And then you're the one that everyone kind of gravitates to at work, because you don't fluster. And you can actually keep a level head about it, and that transfers over into your personal life. Because if you're not coming home stressed because you actually enjoy what you're doing, your whole work-life balance is going to be a lot more stable.
Come on. Yes, Ms. Ells.
You've all done so wonderfully in such a short period of time, but I wonder, do you have an ultimate
I got close to mine. I interviewed for it and I was told they're going to keep my resume on file for it. It was, it goes back to the question you asked about, have you ever been in a situation where things didn't work out? Well, while I was in LA, you make a lot of contacts with people, and one girl I worked with, she was a training manager at the hotel, she changed jobs. And then this past winter, I took my now wife out there for a week. We went to Universal Studios, and my friend who works there now, she goes, oh, text me, we'll meet for a ride. We'll go on a ride together, and we'll have lunch and stuff. So we're talking, and she's got her walkie on her, and I'm just thinking, this is just really weird. Why is HR wearing a walkie walking around the park? And we're talking, I'm like, she's setting me up for something. And finally I bit, and she goes, would you ever move out back out here? And I said, well, it'd have to be for something really fun, something like this. And she just picked up the walk and goes, meet us at the Mummy. I was like, oh, crap. So we got off the ride, and the director of HR for the park was there waiting for me. They had the director of guest services job open, and I think it was one of the final three. So I hopefully will end up back out there, but we'll see what happens with that. But that was something just because I met someone, and we worked together for 3 months, and that led to one other thing. So, you know, you never know when it's going to hit, but that's kind of what I'd end up loving to do.
And for me, I'm a step away. The ultimate goal for me is to be, you know, the boss, the athletic director. You know, I did my Newbury internship at the high school level. Grad school was at the college level. So I'm still torn of which way I want to go. You know, so, but the ultimate goal is to be an athletic director. So close, but not there yet.
Yeah, I really like what I do right now. But there's always, I've always would love to do it if I could ever do it. Guys like UFC or WWE, guys like that, love to be a ring announcer. I would love that. That would be great. No, seriously, you get to travel the world, different venues. You control the crowd. I mean, I couldn't believe Ronda Rousey lost the other night. Right? Yeah, that was a shock.
I did not see that coming.
No, not at all. Not at all. You strike me as a UFC fan, Claire. But yeah, that or WWE being in front of 100,000 people at WrestleMania or something, a ring announcer, that'd be a blast. But other than that, right now, very happy.
Okay. Tough to follow that up. But again, I also love what I'm doing right now. I don't want to change it much. Once I get too old to work in the kitchen and my back starts going and my knees start going, so basically the age of 30, I do want to end up going back to school, and I want to end up teaching, whether it be high school culinary or maybe come up to college and teach that, because I want to get the younger people involved in the passion for food as much as I do.
For me, I love what I do now. I actually am fortunate to, I did my college internship with my boss, who's my current boss now, and I just love working with him again, and so I'm very happy where I am now. I'm not sure exactly what I want to do when I grow up, so trying to figure that out, but it's definitely something in hotels. I mean, it's my passion, it's all I know, it's what I love, so I'm still trying to figure it out.
That's great. Well, thank you so much for joining us today. This was wonderful. For our alumni here on the panel, as well as in the audience, we hope that you will stay on campus today. We are going to have tours leaving from the Mitten House lobby at 3 o'clock if you would like to see the new Student Success Center and the other great changes that have been happening here at your alma mater. So thank you so much, and thank you, everyone, for joining us today.